Jamie has been a co-conspirator on this project since the very beginning, and contributed to the catalog and was really provided the intellectual framework for this exhibition, and I want to thank him for that. I should also say that he had another project he was working on at the same time, which was the Milton Avery exhibition, which is up at the Bennington Museum as we speak. And if you haven't seen that, you all should make a beeline to Bennington. Last week in the Wall Street Journal, the art historian Brian Allen wrote, "Mere mortals could not have organized a better exhibition than the Milton Avery show." So I think that's Robert and Jamie. And had I had a little more time this week, I would have gotten t-shirts made up that said "Mere Mortal" for the two of them. So it's a beautiful show with a wonderful catalog, and they should be very, very proud that they have two projects up in Vermont this summer. Jamie has been curator at the Bennington Museum since 2005. He studied art history at the University of Washington and Williams College, where he earned his master's. His curatorial work and scholarship has focused on American art of the early to mid-20th century, with a particular emphasis on the intersection of modernism and self-taught art. He has organized exhibitions and written books, essays, and articles featuring artists and topics including Erastus Salisbury Field, grassroots art, impressionism, Rockwell Kent, Anna Mary Robertson Moses, and Alice Neal. His 2014 exhibition, Alice Neal, Erastus Salisbury Field, Painting the People, was recognized by the Wall Street Journal as one of the most memorable exhibitions of the year. Please join me in welcoming Jamie to the podium.
Well, thank you. It's really a delight to be here. And I just want to extend my thanks to Tom for nudging me along, despite the other things I had on my plate over the course of the last year and a half. When we pulled this exhibition together, the staff here at the Shelburne has been wonderful to work with. And of course, all of the people at the Bennington Museum who helped me get through the last year working on these two simultaneous projects. I'm going to be using my essay that I wrote for the catalog as kind of a framework, but I like to kind of jump off topic on occasion. So I'm going to try to keep the narrative as linear as possible, but I'm going to dive in and kind of give you a sense of the way in which Grandma Moses fit into the larger picture of the modernist narrative. Jane and Katie have done a wonderful job of kind of setting the scene, and I'm going to dig a little deeper, and I'm going to cover a lot of the same topics, but I think in different ways, so that we can begin to see Grandma Moses as the really amazing artist and painter that she was, and how she fit into the larger picture. Between 1936 and 1938, the Museum of Modern Art, under the directorship of Alfred H. Barr Jr., organized three exhibitions: Cubism and Abstract Art, of which the study for Demoiselles d'Avignon is in the upper left. The MoMA didn't own the actual picture until 1939, so they represented it with a reproduction in this study in that exhibition. Fantastic Art, Dada and Surrealism, represented at the upper right by Paul Klee's Actor's Mask from 1924, which again was in that exhibition, and Masters of Popular Painting, Modern Primitives of Europe and America. And these three exhibitions were intended, in Barr's word, to be a series that, quote, to present in an objective and historical manner the principal movements of modern art, end quote. The first two exhibitions in the series represented undisputed masters of modernism, almost exclusively from Europe, such as I have already mentioned, Pablo Picasso and Paul Klee. Masters of Popular Painting, on the other hand, featured the work of mostly little-known painters from Europe, including Henri Rousseau, who was by far the most famous of the group and still is to this day, I would say, is a fair way of assessing it, as well as America, including Edward Hicks, whose picture in the upper left in the collection here at Shelburne and in the exhibition, and John Kane, a representative example of his work at lower right. There's a wonderful landscape in the exhibition as well that Jane and the folks at Gallery Saint-Étienne helped us bring to this exhibition. All of these artists, Rousseau, the other Europeans, Hicks, Kane, and the other consort of American self-taught artists who were in this exhibition had little or no formal training in the arts and created their work beyond the boundary of the, quote, art world of their time and place, at least prior to their supposed discovery by the art world insiders. It's hard not to take issue with Barr's claim that his attempt to codify the history of modern art was objective in any sense of the word. He even created a chart, the most tantalizingly objective of visual formats, attempting to trace the interconnections and development of the various isms of modern art, which graced the dust jacket for the catalog to cubism and abstract art. In its visual convolutions, this chart makes clear just how complex a topic Barr was tackling. 80 years later, it seems perfectly clear that the divisions, bifurcations, and linkages that Barr was attempting to codify begin to break down at even the simplest of queries. What, for example, makes Rousseau's painting a precedent for cubism, as he's indicated here on the chart? Rousseau up on his own in the upper right with an arrow pointing to cubism. Beyond the fact that Picasso and other progenitors of the style admired his work. Barr himself, despite his claim of objectivity, acknowledged that the reality of modernism was far more complex than he could possibly encapsulate in a single exhibition or chart. He made his survey serial in nature. The three exhibitions I already have mentioned were the first. There are a couple of other. It's difficult sorting through all of the archival materials which they considered part of that series. There was one on romantic realism in 1943, et cetera. But basically, he made his series of exhibitions to kind of codify modern art serial. He made revisions to his chart over time, which he never considered definitive, and noted, for example, that by 1936, an artist such as Picasso was creating works that could be classified as both cubist and surrealist, or both simultaneously. Just as Barr recognized that the boundaries between cubism and surrealism were permeable, so too did he make clear that the distinctions between so-called folk artists and their counterparts who worked within the context of the mainstream art world were equally tenuous, stating in his introduction to Masters of Popular Painting that, quote, "The purpose of this exhibition is to show, without apology or condescension, the paintings of some of these individuals, not as folk art, but as the work of painters of marked talent and consistently distinct personality," end quote. Despite the flaws and inconsistencies in Barr's larger agenda, this statement of purpose for Masters of Popular Painting is still relevant today, 80 years later, as we continue the art historical struggle to break down such deeply rooted biases as the false dichotomies between high and low art or artists that are classified as insiders or outsiders. Masters of Popular Painting was far from an anomaly in MoMA's early exhibition programming. From its inception in 1929, MoMA had what the art historian Thomas Crowe has recently called, quote, "a dual commitment to European modernism and the art of the common man in America." This agenda was particularly strong between 1932, when acting director Holger Cahill organized The Art of the Common Man, American Folk Art, 1750 to 1900, which consisted almost solely of works of early American art from the collection of MoMA founder Abby Aldrich Rockefeller. Joseph Pickett, whose painting is in the upper left and is in the exhibition here, it's a wonderful coup to be able to have this because there's only a few of them out there in the world. He was included in that exhibition organized by Cahill at the Museum of Modern Art in 1932. This commitment to popular painting, The Art of the Common Man, was particularly strong at MoMA between 1932, when that exhibition was organized, and 1943, when Barr was dismissed from his position as director in no small part, as Katie's already mentioned, to his enthusiastic support of self-taught artists, including a solo exhibition of Morris Hirschfeld's work. And here at the lower right, we have Hirschfeld's Stage Beauties, of which the study for this painting is in the exhibition here at Shelburne. It was from within this complex historical nexus of folk art and modernism that Anna Mary Robertson, Grandma Moses, was catapulted to international fame. Today, Moses is the best-known artistic autodidact of the 20th century, and her work is often perceived as exceptional, somehow operating outside the mainstream of art history, and certainly distinct from the productions of such modern artists as Picasso, whose early cubist landscape we see at upper left, and Jackson Pollock, who Katie so wonderfully brought into her talk, and I'll mention a couple of times more as we get into mine. Yet I would argue that Moses' art and its reception are integral to a full understanding of the history of modern art in America. In 1939, the year after Masters of Popular Painting, MoMA presented two exhibitions that are revealing in their rather startling juxtaposition. From October 18th to November 18th, the museum debuted three of Moses' paintings to an art world audience in an exhibition, Contemporary Unknown American Painters, curated by the influential collector and later dealer Sidney Janis. This was an exclusive members-only show than a common practice at MoMA, which writer and collector Diana Korzenek, who also contributed to the catalog for this exhibition, has compared to, quote, insider trading. Overlapping slightly with this exhibition was a much more public one, Picasso, 40 Years of His Art, on view November 15, 1939, so overlapping with the exhibition in which Moses' works appeared by 3 days, through January 7, 1940, the largest retrospective of Picasso's work to date, and the first major retrospective of his work in the United States, which featured more than 300 of his paintings. While the overlap of these two exhibitions may have been purely coincidental, the relationship between the work of Moses and Picasso, as well as other modernists, was definitely not inconsequential or superficial. Moses' work and the debates that have surrounded it since her introduction to the mainstream art world serve as a nearly perfect litmus test for understanding the complexity, politics, and contradictions of modern art in America from the late 1930s until her death in 1961 and beyond. And I just show these sorts of juxtapositions just to show the sort of kind of relationship that Moses' work had purely visually. Now, these weren't intentional relationships. You know, Robert asked earlier the Europeans' interest in surrealism and cubism during this point. Grandma Moses didn't intentionally create a kind of cubist sense of perspective and space in her painting at the lower right, Autumn. But as Jane mentioned, and I'll get into here shortly, her use of disparate sources, though she was able to cohere them into these beautifully complete, stylistically seamless holes, often the kind of disjunction in space between her multiple sources create this kind of sense of cubist space. In the decade after her introduction to the art world, Moses went from being an unknown farm wife in rural upstate New York who happened to paint to an international artist celebrity. In 1950, as Katie has so already wonderfully evaluated, an exhibition of 50 of her paintings organized by Otto Collier, the director of the Gallery Saint-Étienne, under the auspices of the U.S. Information Service, made her work available for the first time to a hungry European public. The tour began in Vienna at Collier's former Neue Gallery, where he had been one of the earliest champions of Austrian expressionists such as Gustav Klimt, Egon Schiele, and Oskar Kokoschka. And I put up one of Schiele's wonderful landscape watercolors in the upper left, echoing in a sort of patchwork, quilt-like effect of Moses' own landscapes, just again to give you this sort of visual parallels between her work and other modernists. And of course, it was in Vienna before traveling, as Katie has told us, to the Netherlands, Germany, and Switzerland, and finishing up in Paris, the, quote, birthplace of modern art. While Moses had entered the art world through no less an arbiter of taste than MoMA, over the course of the 1940s, her exploding popularity outside the marble halls of museums and her overwhelming commercial success made her work suspect to the majority of American critics, who by and large bemoaned the European tour of Moses' work, as Katie has already so aptly described to us. But as the cultural critic Lucy Lepard later pointed out, this practice of negating work that, quote, communicates to a dangerous number of people is a blatantly classist attitude, end quote. By 1950, American critics had widely embraced abstract expressionism, claiming it to be the first American victory in an international war over artistic supremacy. However, in the aftermath of the horrors of World War II, which Europe experienced much more directly than Europe, the French critics and public ate up Moses' pictures. As one American in Paris summarized, the French response to Moses' work, quote, "She is bound to mean the most to everyday people living in an unhappy world who, during the few minutes they look at grandma's pictures, drink in her memory of a happy world," end quote. The Musée National d'Art Moderne, better known today as the Centre Pompidou, acquired Moses' paintings, The Dead Tree, which we see here, a decidedly unhappy subject matter, it must be noted, even if set in a bucolic landscape after the exhibition, making it the first painting by a contemporary American artist to enter the prestigious institution's permanent collection. Most critics, whether in America or abroad, positive or negative, put Moses and her work in stark contrast to the darker, angst-ridden strains of modern art, notably abstract expressionism. Yet, she still served in many ways as the perfect symbol of a modern artist, unshackled by the expectations of the art world. It could be argued that her insistence on painting happy pictures, as she called them, was unexpectedly bold in the context of a morose post-war world. Exemplifying this attitude is a cartoon-like caricature of Moses, sent to her by an admirer from Paris, presumably around the time of her debut there in 1950. In the drawing, Moses' body is grossly contorted, and she confrontationally, though with a smile on her face, stands before a bed that has been stood on end. With a traditional artist's palette in one hand and a dripping paintbrush in the other, she seems to be attaching the picture plane, in this case, the bedsheet. Prior to her discovery, Moses did in fact paint on a variety of found objects, including the base of this tilt-top table, which is in the collection of the Bennington Museum, that had been passed down in her family since the 18th century and served as Moses' improvised easel. When she was working, she used other tables. We have another one of her working tables in our collection. Though in reality, she would have never used an actual artist's palette. She was far too practical for that. Moses actually used repurposed jar lids, such as the one that you see in the lower right, which is an actual Moses palette, to mix her colors. The imagined painting in this caricature is a stereotypical, though not very Moses-like, rural scene, with the sun shining down upon a prim little farmhouse, surrounded by a smiling sheep, a horse-drawn plow, and a young girl holding flowers. The drawing mythologizes Moses as a cross between a benign farm wife and a wild woman who painted on any surface she could find. The admirer, Jean Gambotti, has depicted Moses as the quintessential peintre naïf, or naive painter, which was the term that was commonly used to describe self-taught artists in France around this time, the embodiment of the American rags-to-riches, hard-working ideal. Paired with one of Hans Nemeth's iconic photographs of Pollock, the other American artist taking the world by storm in 1950, I cannot help but think that we are looking at the king and queen of modern art. Pollock was born in Wyoming, grew up in the American West, and found inspiration in the ephemeral sound paintings created by the indigenous peoples of the American Southwest. Dancing around an unstretched canvas spread out on his studio floor, he flings skeins of house paint directly out of the can, exemplifying the wild and woolly modern artist as primitive other. Moses and her work were commonly referred to as primitive, a term she personally loathed. It was a label used during the period to describe pretty much any artists who weren't part of the modern artistic establishment in Europe and America, and less, of course, to describe the nature of their inspiration. From makers of African masks to medieval sculptors to, of course, little old ladies who lived a few hours train ride up the Hudson River from New York City. At the core of Moses's artistic success was her personal, deeply felt approach to landscape painting. In her autobiography, Moses spent far more time describing childhood memories than her more recent artistic fame. These recollections are filled with metaphors connecting life to Earth's natural rhythms and detailed, almost transcendent descriptions of her experiences in nature. Quote, and this is Moses writing, "In the springtime of life, there is plenty to do. Oh, those damp, snowy days early in spring when we love to go to the woods and look for the first bloom of the trailing arbutus, which sometimes blossoms beneath the snow, or to gather the pussy willows, feeling nearer to God's intentions, nearer to nature," end quote. Moses also provides us with a basic outline of her artistic mindset. Following a matter-of-fact description of the mechanical process of preparing a masonite board for a picture, quote, "I go over the board with linseed oil, then with three coats of flat white paint." Moses dives into an evocative description of her approach to divining an image, quote, "Now the board is ready for the scene, whatever the mind may produce, a landscape, an old bridge, a dream, or a summer or winter scene, childhood memories," end quote. I'm particularly struck here by the phrase, whatever the mind may produce. Moses' paintings have often been discussed as if they are factual visual records of her lived experience. It is often forgotten that Moses was first and foremost an artist, not a historian or documentarian. Her mind was occupied by the unlimited possibilities of the imagination, and she felt very little obligation to record facts in the traditional sense of the word. Actually, as I was preparing for this talk, long after I had written my essay for the catalog, I stumbled across a review of the first Jean Dubuffet exhibition here in the United States in 1947 by Henry McBride. And she, as any critic during this period, he brought up Moses as the counterpoint to modern art and says that she dwells in facts. And I think that's a common perception, but I think it's a misperception. Yes, facts were important to Moses, but she liked to play with them just as she liked to play with her clippings and move them around and rearrange them as she saw fit. In an interview, she clarified that while she did make careful observations of nature, her basic approach to landscape painting was deeply intuitive. Quote, I look out the window sometimes to seek the color of the shadows and the different greens in the trees, but when I get ready to paint, I just close my eyes and imagine a scene. End quote. Helen Frankenthaler emerged on the national stage a few years after Moses, sharing her close ties to Bennington. In fact, we have somebody in the audience who was a Bennington College grad who gave Grandma Moses a ride in a convertible. It was her first ride. So she had deeper ties to this larger world around her than I think we often give her credit for. She wasn't the exotic other. She was exceptional as an artist, but she lived a fairly typical life for a middle-class American in mid-20th century America. Her lyrical, highly emotive abstraction, speaking of Frankenthaler, of atmosphere, personal associations, and place, are often cited as the next step after Pollock in the supposedly linear progression of modernism. Frankenthaler herself noted that while you could only ape most abstract expressionists, quote, you could depart from Pollock. And her fellow painter, Morris Lewis, claimed that Frankenthaler's work was the bridge between Pollock and what was possible. Frankenthaler's approach to landscape, particularly during the 1950s, her first decade as a mature artist, was not all that different from Moses's, even if the end products are markedly different. Describing the creation of her seminal masterpiece from 1952, which we see on the screen, and 52 was just 3 years after she had graduated from Bennington College, Frankenthaler recalled, quote, I painted mountains and seas after seeing the cliffs of Nova Scotia. It's a hilly landscape with wild surf rolling against the rocks. Though it was painted in a windowless loft, the memory of the landscape is in the painting, end quote. Finishing with the caveat, quote, but it also has equal amounts of cubism, Pollock, Kandinsky, Gorky, end quote. Much like Moses, Frankenthaler held the landscape inside herself and simply let it pour out, literally in her case, splashing thinned oil paints directly from a coffee can onto unprimed canvas. Unlike Moses, Frankenthaler was deeply knowledgeable about the history of art and contemporary artistic trends, recalling Salvador Dali's famous painting Persistence of Memory as the first she ever stood in front of and talked about with her sister Marjorie. On a separate occasion, Frankenthaler noted, quote, I've been touched by a surrealist, and by surrealist I mean associative quality. It's what comes through an association after your eye has experienced the surface of a great picture. It's incidental, but can be enriching. I leave it out of my own pictures more and more as I become increasingly involved with colors and shapes, but it's still there. And I think we can talk about this. I quote Hans Hoffmann, who Frankenthaler studied with briefly in Provincetown. And I'm paraphrasing here because I don't have the quote in front of me, but it's in the label in the gallery. The difference between naturalism and abstract painting isn't all that great. The formal elements are all the same. I mean, it's this idea that this divide between non-objective painting and naturalism is, I think, one of the things that made it hard for the larger American public to accept her work as modern, as something that was of the age in the 1950s and 60s, when they were seeing so much more abstract, non-representational painting being touted by the leading critics. as much as her paintings might be built upon the memory or evocation of a specific landscape, and this is again is Frankenthaler I'm speaking of, they were equally tied up with the formal elements of art. For Frankenthaler, the most successful paintings walked a tightrope, balancing pictorial depth with the flatness of the canvas. Quote, the why of how a picture works best for me involves how much working false space it has in depth. It's a play of ambiguities, end quote. Silver Coast, on loan to the Moses exhibition from Bennington College, was painted during Frankenthaler's 1958 honeymoon with fellow artist Robert Motherwell, and like her more famous Mountains and Seas, she walks a tightrope between the evocation of place, note the striped beach cabanas in the lower left, and the formal elements of painting. She wasn't a non-representational painter, certainly not at this point in her career. Like Moses, she was soaking in the landscape and she was letting her response to the landscape come out. It was a different type of response than Moses, but it's not all that different. While Moses may not have been familiar with terms such as perspectival space or the critic Clement Greenberg's ideas about the integrity of the picture plane, her best landscapes demonstrate that she intuitively came to similar conclusions as Frankenthaler. Moses noted, quote, I like to paint something that leads me on and on into the unknown, something that I want to see, a way on, beyond, end quote, simultaneously expressing her interest in drawing the viewer into a false pictorial space while emphasizing an overriding desire to convey a sense of mystery, or as Frankenthaler may have put it, ambiguity. In paintings like White Creek, which we see at the lower left, and Hoosick Valley from the window at upper right, Moses's delicate atmospheric transitions of color from rich forest and vivid grassy greens in the foreground to softer minty and sage greens in the middle ground, melting into the soft blues of the background hills and sky, combined with the complex topography of Washington County's rolling hills that drop steeply downward into the river valley below before rising precipitously to a relatively high horizon line, creating a complex, slightly baffling effect of simultaneous depth and flatness. A similar effect of push and pull can be found in Moses's The Baker Home. The snow-covered banks framing the left and right foreground, along with the trees in the foreground and middle ground, flatten the pictorial space, as does Moses's typically scumbled, highly textural surface. While the bands of starkly contrasting color that form the bold curve of the road, shadowed snowbank, and glistening reflection pull the viewer into the typically expansive scene. The subtle overall blue-gray tonality of the painting brings everything into unity. Moses often drew on memories of places or events that she had experienced as much as 80 or 90 years prior, or passed down stories of, quote, old-timey things, as she would have called them, from an even hazier past. Yet, those recollections or borrowed stories were almost heavily covered by her ongoing relationship to the same landscape in which they had taken place, which she continued to experience on a daily basis. Take, for example, Moses's The Battle of Bennington, which we see on the screen from 1953, which depicts the historic Revolutionary War conflict of August 16, 1777, as if it were taking place before our eyes, yet includes the monument built to commemorate the battle over 100 years later in the upper right-hand corner, its reflection shimmering on the surface of the Loomsack River that winds its way below. And I'll make note of that reflection. You don't often see reflections and shadows in self-taught artists' work, and I think that points out that monument was important to Moses. She put it there for a very real reason. Moses lived most of her adult life only a few miles from the site of the battle, and had lived even closer to the monument itself, located 10 miles away in Bennington proper, between 1932 and 1935, while caring for her ailing daughter and her two granddaughters. Understandably, she associated the monument with the battle, and it made sense to her to include it in her painting, not just as an anachronistic symbol, but on artistic grounds as well. In a 1955 television interview, the newsman Edward R. Murrow slyly asked Moses why she had included the monument in the painting, and she answered quite simply, without skipping a beat, well, I put the monument in because it looked good, I guess. And I think that quote captures Moses' sensibility as an artist and as a person better than any that I know. She was an artist, and while the monument's in there because it looks good, and not just because it looks good, but also because it's what she associated with the battle. If you want to paint a picture of the Battle of Bennington, you have to paint markers so people know it's the Battle of Bennington, and she did that in a lot of her work, including things, you know, I think Jane touched on this. Her paintings are combinations of both her memories and her lived experience, the experience of mid-20th century America, which she lived in and partook in, like everybody else. The temporal relationship between the experience of a place and the translation of that experience into a painting was fluid for Frankenthaler as well. In 1958, Frankenthaler created a small group of paintings inspired by her personal encounters with the prehistoric cave paintings of Altamira, Spain, and Lazo, France. She recalled her initial experience of encountering the paintings at Altamira in 1953 in a postcard to Clement Greenberg, who was her partner at the time. Quote, "It all looks like one huge painting on unsized canvas. It all reminded me a lot of my pictures," end quote, drawing a direct link between herself and the prehistoric painters, taking on the mantle of modern as primitive as Pollock had before her. Yet it wasn't until 5 years later, working with what the curator John Elderfield has described as anticipatory imagination, that she executed her first paintings inspired by the prehistoric images and their subterranean context. Before the Caves, which we see on the screen, was created shortly before Frankenthaler's 1958 honeymoon to France and Spain, the same honeymoon in which she painted Silver Coast, which is in the exhibit here, with the artist Robert Motherwell, when she revisited Altamira and experienced the caves in Lazo for the first time. During that trip, she executed Hotel Cro-Magnon, which we see here at right, named after the hotel where she was staying and inspired by a famed depiction of a horned bovine at Lazo. Despite having been executed in the closest temporal proximity to her actual experience of the caves, Hotel Cro-Magnon may well have drawn inspiration from a postcard depicting the famed Lazo Bull with its distinctive undulating black outline, a copy of which we see the actual postcard that Helen Frankenthaler sent to a friend from the Hotel Cro-Magnon, in 1958. It seems memory wasn't the only resource Frankenthaler was able or willing to draw from. Drawing inspiration from commercially produced images, such as the postcard of a cave painting, wasn't standard practice for Frankenthaler, though she frequently paid homage to her art historical heroes and compositions that were based very directly on favorite paintings from the past. Moses, on the other hand, was outright omnivorous when it came to stealing already existing imagery for her work, echoing Picasso's famous quip, "When there's anything to steal, I steal." A postcard, which we see at the top of the screen, featuring a panoramic fisheye photo of prominent buildings in Bennington's commercial center, serves as the compositional spine for Moses' painting Bennington of 1945, in much the same manner as the image of the bull served as the anchor for Frankenthaler's composition, which we just saw a minute ago. Though the buildings are heavily distorted by the fisheye effect of the photograph, difficult to identify even for longtime Bennington residents, Moses nonetheless transferred the image quite directly to her painting, even partially maintaining the black and white postcard's grisaille color scheme. She seemingly improvised the rest of the scene, undoubtedly drawing heavily on other unidentified sources, making it even harder to decipher as Bennington, except for a few potentially identifiable landmark structures, such as the Old First Church and the Battle Monument, which are the two white spires right of center in the midground. And I have theories that that gambrel on the lower left may have been the house in which she lived for a short time in Bennington. I actually lived across the street from it. It's a gambrel that looks very similar to that one, though she probably based this on a picture of a gambrel that she found in a magazine. But it's that way that her memory and her experience went back and forth. Yes, that's a specific house but it may not be drawn from an image of the actual house that she remembers. It's a typical gambrel house. House that reminds her of the house that she lived in Bennington. Well, it has long been recognized that Moses drew inspiration from Currier and Ives lithographs. The full extent of this practice in Moses' work is difficult to fully grasp, as this aspect of her artistic process is nearly invisible in the finished product, and it is difficult to pin down all of her original sources. However, thanks to the survival of at least two substantive caches of her, quote, secret source materials, now in the archives of the Galerie Saint-Étienne in New York, we can begin to cobble together a picture, much as Moses herself did, of a sophisticated process. It is impossible to say exactly what percentage of the artist's paintings are based on her voluminous collection of clippings, but given the surviving evidence, it's safe to say that the majority of her figures, animals, and buildings, and even a large percentage of her landscape elements, were directly traced or adapted in some form from pre-existing imagery. The complexity and sophistication of the various ways in which she incorporated these sources into her paintings is astounding. Some Moses paintings, such as the old house at the bend of the road at lower left and Thanksgiving Day at lower right, are based directly on Currier and Ives lithographs, which we see the inspirations directly above them. With expected adjustments to color and the substitution or addition of a new figure or tree here or there, even in these direct, uncomplicated borrowings, Moses improves upon the originals. Her lively, unhackneyed application of paint, luminous color, and expansive compositional sensibility bring the otherwise traditional images to life. Though I wonder what Duncan Phillips, one of the leading modern art tastemakers in America, would have thought if he knew that the first Moses he acquired, he purchased the old house at the bend of the road in 1941, January of 1941, just a few months after her first solo exhibition at the Galerie Saint-Étienne, was based on a Currier and Ives lithograph. I'm not sure that he would have been happy about that, but that doesn't make it any less of an interesting picture. And while I have it up on the screen, I'll note, I'm going to be talking about her process in some depth now. You can kind of see some ghosts of cows in the lower right corner. You can just make out their outline. She probably actually, I have a suspicion she might have actually directly collaged cutouts, possibly from a reproduction of the actual lithograph, and for whatever reason decided to take them off before she finished the picture, which again gives you a little sense of a kind of a glimpse into her creative process. She was always making very conscious decisions about where she placed things, the associations that she drew. Hildegard Backart, who's a co-director at the Galerie Saint-Étienne, said she would go up and spend the night at the Moses place in White Creek, and she'd look at a painting at the end of the day, and they'd look at it, talk about it a little bit. She'd wake up after Grandma Moses in the morning and go in, and there was a new tree on the right. And she said she had this intuitive sense of composition. She knew how to create balance and create successful pictures. Far more interesting and aesthetically successful was Moses' more common practice of cobbling her paintings together from many sources, rarely identifiable, into cohesive, balanced wholes. It would be hard to convey just how extensively Moses' work depended on sources clipped or otherwise borrowed from popular periodicals such as the Saturday Evening Post. You see a Norman Rockwell Saturday Evening Post on the right. That address label says Mrs. T.S. Moses. That's an actual Saturday Evening Post that she had clipped for whatever reason. Obviously, those aren't very Moses-like images, so I don't know why she preserved this clipping, but it's part of her larger cache of images that she saved. Time and Life magazines, farmers' almanacs, greeting and holiday cards, postcards, photographs, chromolithographs, and just about any other image that passed through her hand served as inspiration. And she didn't just borrow from generic commercial illustrations, as she seems to have made little distinction between, quote, high and low sources. All that mattered to Moses was that the image carried an associative quality that stirred her memories and imagination. Surviving clippings in her archives include reproductions of paintings by such well-known artists as Luigi Lucioni. This isn't the actual clipping. The clipping is in the from Moses' archives is actually in the exhibition. This is a famous painting by Luigi Lucioni, which was used for advertisements by Maxwell House. I think the reproduction in Moses' archive was an advertisement for the Associated American Artists, which reproduced affordable prints by popular living artists of the day and many of Lucioni's etchings. In fact, there's an etching based on this painting that was very popular and widely distributed during the time. and Norman Rockwell, who I had met, already mentioned, both of whom lived nearby in Vermont and were acquainted with Moses personally. They would have known each other from social gatherings, her birthday party. Moses Rockwell decorated Moses's cake for one of her birthdays, and she would have known Luigi Lucioni from their connections to the Southern Vermont Art Center in Manchester, where they both exhibited their work. And claims of the similarity of Moses's paintings to 17th century Dutch old masters such as Bruegel, which have often been brushed off with an insistence that she had never seen them, should be reconsidered. No, she had never seen an original Bruegel in the flesh, but that doesn't mean that she wasn't familiar with his work for reproductions. And there is a reproduction of Peter Bruegel the Younger's Winter Landscape with Skaters and Bird Trap, which you see in the lower left, as part of her cache of archives, source materials at the Galerie Saint-Étienne, with its depiction of wintertime recreation, a subject dear to Moses, which she would have clearly been drawn to. There are even clippings of reproductions of her own paintings with pencil outlines, indicating that she stole from herself. The reproduction at the right, which is in the exhibition, it's difficult to see on this reproduction, but obviously it was a working source material. There's splotches of paint on it, and if you look closely at the original in the gallery, there are tracings. And so I'll describe her process of borrowing these materials shortly, but any time when you see one pencil tracings on one of her source materials, that's the figure or the house or the tree that she was adopting into her own visual language. Moses's painting in Harvest Time, which was here on view in the gallery along with some of the source material right next to it, serves as a good example of the artist's practice of appropriation. The gray clapboard house, left of center, the overflowing wagon in the lower right foreground, the stack of hay and figures at right center, and the horse-drawn threshing machine to the left of the tree in the upper right quadrant are all drawn from separate clippings that originally had no relationship to one another. She wasn't taking figures all from one picture and rearranging them. She was taking pictures from everywhere and bringing them together into her own imagined world. Not only did the individual borrowed elements within a single picture have no direct relationship with one another to begin with, Moses often pulled figures completely out of context to suit her artistic needs. A figure of a young boy running after a turkey and catching the turkey, the original painting at the upper left, and the boy running after the turkey in the lower left corner in the red hat, and many other versions of the same subject matter, for example, is taken from a Saturday evening post cover of a family picnicking. And we see the original clipping from the Moses archive at lower left and a full reproduction of the actual cover that it was clipped from at right. The boy in this original context was frolicking playfully with other children, not chasing after a turkey so that it could be caught and its head could be cut off for Thanksgiving dinner. Moses had a knack for finding images of figures that powerfully convey abstract visual information via posture and body language, and she did this constantly throughout her work. When she found a figure that she particularly liked, she would use it in multiple paintings, such as the child with his back to the viewer running into the fictive space of the paintings in the center right foregrounds of Sugaring Off. You see the original painting at the upper left and the boy, the detail which is at the very bottom right of center of the composition, and Over the River to Grandmother's House. Again, the original painting, the same figure borrowed for a boy running into the space, kind of bottom center. Just in the process of pulling together this presentation, I found two other Moses paintings, including a version of Catching the Turkey with the same figure. So she had a figure, she liked it, she wanted to use it, and she would just recycle it over and over again in different compositions. It is often claimed that Picasso and Georges Braque invented collage, or the direct pasting of printed paper scraps onto the picture plane in 1912. More accurately, they simply introduced the technique, long popular among amateur art makers, especially women, into the fine art realm, as feminist artists and theories were quick to point out in the 1970s. Moses's collage-like practice grows directly out of artistic strategies common among children and non-professional artists during the second half of the 19th century, as seen in the dozens of late 19th century tracing books in Diana Korzenek's collection of art education ephemera, now part of the Huntington Library Collection in San Marino, California. And you see that tracing kit, which is a tracing kit from the mid-1880s, the exact same process that Grandma Moses used in her paintings, borrowed cutouts, die cutouts that you could trace. You were given a watercolor palette, which you could then take that tracing and color it in as you like. It's the exact same process that Grandma Moses followed in her own work. Painting Moses made on the 18th century tilt top that descended in her family is the only extant example of which I'm familiar with of direct collage in the artist's oeuvre. In this detail, clippings of a stone house, which you see at upper right, a small figure, which is difficult to read in this image, but it's just directly below the wheel for the windmill or the grist mill, center left, and then three cows have all been pasted directly to the painted surface and painted over to integrate them into the scene. Moses consciously tried to hide her practice of borrowing imagery, and it was little known outside of her family or close circle of friends and rarely mentioned in discussions of her work during the artist's life. The most common method that Moses used to transfer these images to her paintings was to directly trace them with pencil over carbon paper onto the pristine white surface of her prepared Masonite board, though larger studies on onion skin tracing paper with multiple figures, which Jane showed us an example of, were often used to transfer larger compositional studies, whole cloth, to the. So she would probably trace the figure from a source onto the onion skin, then she would take that onion skin and trace it over carbon paper onto the pristine white surface of her Masonite board. Rather than traditional pasted paper collage as she used on the base of her tilt-top table, this technique might be better called uncollage, a term invented by the artist and curator Todd Bartel to describe a sort of reverse engineering that combines multiple borrowed image sources into a cohesive painted whole without leaving any trace of their disparate origins. This technique of combining multiple unrelated clippings into distinct new images echoes the practice of another of America's best-known self-taught artists of the mid-20th century, Joseph Cornell. We see a wonderful photograph of him at the upper left by Duane Michaels, which is a little bit of a plug. We have an exhibition of Duane Michaels' work down at the Bennington Museum right now through the end of October, as well as a permanent gallery devoted to Moses' paintings. So you can come down and see more of Moses' work and see some of Michaels' work. He's actually going to be at the museum next Saturday evening from 6 to 8 talking about his work and previewing some of his new recent films. So do come down to Bennington if you're able. So though Cornell ran in progressive cultural circles and is typically understood to be an integral part of America's artistic avant-garde from the mid-1930s until his death in 1972, like Moses, he came to his practice completely independent of any academic training. In a way, the introduction of surrealism to America, largely through the Julian Levy Gallery in New York, where Cornell first exhibited his work, provided a framework to understand Cornell's assemblages of found objects and images as, quote, fine art. Though best known for his boxed constructions, collage formed a critical aspect of Cornell's artistic practice from the early 1930s to the mid-1940s, and again, late in his career. Cornell kept his source materials filed in his basement studio, which we see at lower right, in some 150 loosely categorized, highly personal dossiers, which he described, quote, as a diary, journal, repository, laboratory, picture gallery, museum, sanctuary, observatory, key, the core of a labyrinth, a clearinghouse for dreams and visions, childhood regained, end quote. This poetic description beautifully echoes Moses' less structured system. Diana Korzenek recalls Moses sharing her art secrets when she visited the artist as a young girl, pulling out a large painted trunk filled with clippings that she would riffle through to find inspiration. Typical of Cornell's collages is a design he created for the front and back covers of an issue of the avant-garde arts magazine, View, in 1943. Serving as the opening salvo for a special thematic issue of the magazine whose overarching theme was Americana Fantastica, a term that certainly finds a parallel in Moses' work, Cornell's collage, like Moses' paintings, draws on familiar tropes of resonant, stereotypical American imagery, In his case, they tend to be more iconic, identifiable subjects, such as Niagara Falls, circus performers, Native Americans in feather headdresses, the Empire State Building and King Kong, and their juxtapositions are intended to be provocative and create both visual and psychological tension, as well as a great deal of humor. This is just random, but because I mentioned circus figures right now, there's an absolutely fabulous object downstairs in the poster exhibit. It's a large hunk of like 50 posters that were all adhered to each other over time for a circus that appeared in Bennington and was found on the side of a barn in Hoosick, New York, to kind of give you a sense of the visual culture in which Grandma Moses lived and worked with and was seeing all the time. Occasionally, Moses also created the humorously surreal image, such as horseshoeing at the upper left, with its speeding train and horses headed full tilt toward a group of stationary figures only a few feet away, or Halloween with its bedsheet ghosts and hooded figures wreaking havoc everywhere, including the rooftops. Cornell allowed his source material to speak for itself, pasting his cutouts directly, typically onto a large found landscape image or other found surface, without further alteration beyond their recontextualization. Moses dramatically altered and abstracted the source material in her borrowings, transferring only their bare outlines to a prepared Masonite board, which she then painted over in loosely applied strokes of bright, largely unmodulated color, obliterating any sense of illustrative detail while maintaining the original source's associative quality. The real magic in Moses's paintings is the fact that she is able to pull together such disparate images into cohesive, reassuring wholes, as though they were always meant to be together, as though they were her own memories. Like Moses, Cornell was astoundingly inventive in his use of found sources, often repurposing a favorite image again and again, sometimes decades apart. And here we see a selection of Cornell collages in a box construction that all reference the constellation Cassiopeia, named after a vain queen in Greek mythology who boasted about her unparalleled beauty. And actually, the Cornell collage at upper center is the work that's actually in the exhibition. And then you see reproductions of how he used the same images and material again and again, you know, deeply involved in this sort of seemingly outdated old school imagery and romantic sensibility, very much in keeping with Moses's own creative practice. Moses's life spanned the entire history of modern art. She was a toddler when Edouard Manet painted Le Déjeuner sur l'Herbe and died the year before Andy Warhol's breakthrough exhibition of Campbell's soup cans paintings ushered in postmodernism. Yet, in many ways, her art is more in line with the basic tenets of postmodernism that came to define the art world in the decades immediately after her death, especially pop art of the 1960s and feminist art of the 1970s. Postmodernism saw a breaking down of perceived dichotomies, such as those between high or fine art and low or popular art, which, as we've already seen, was an inherent aspect of Moses' work. This period also saw the advent of grassroots interests in artistic diversity, not just feminism, but identity politics more broadly, and the championing of artists and visual cultures of all types, well beyond the white male hegemony of the New York-centric art world. In describing the artistic mindset of the English predecessors of American pop in the late 1950s, of which Richard Hamilton and his iconic collage, just what is it that makes today's home so different, so appealing, which we see on the screen, was the most famous among this group, the art critic Lawrence Alloway noted, quote, "We assumed an anthropological definition of culture in which all types of human activity were the object of aesthetic judgment and attention," end quote. As unlikely a comparison as it may seem, Warhol, who was a major collector of American folk art and served on the board of the American Folk Art Museum in New York, and is seen at the upper left in an exhibition of his folk art collection at the American Folk Art Museum in 1977, had a surprising amount in common with Moses. As a commercial illustrator in the 1950s, he was just as voracious as Moses in stealing and adapting his imagery from popular printed sources. And given his penchant for celebrity, it's hard to imagine he wasn't drawn to Moses' work at the prestigious Carnegie International exhibitions in his hometown of Pittsburgh, where her work was shown every year from 1945 to 1950, when he was a fledgling young artist. This is not to make a claim of direct influence, of which I think there's probably no case to be made. Rather, I simply find it astounding how resonant Moses' practices were with larger trends in the art world and how little it has been commented upon within the art historical and critical canon. In fact, it seems the only time critics ever cited Moses during the 1950s and the 1970s was in a negative light, as when the art critic Hilton Kramer used her in an attack on Jasper Johns' bold new work in 1959. Quote, his hand-painted American flags, targets, numbers, and so on are a kind of Grandma Moses version of Dada, end quote. After referencing this review in his recent book-length study of the relationship between folk art and the origins of pop art in America, Thomas Crowe wisely questions the surprisingly short-term memory of the New York art world in so quickly forgetting the folk-modern agenda that MoMA had so vigorously promoted just a couple of decades earlier. The artists Miriam Shapiro's and Melissa Meyer's 1978 article, Waste Not, Want Not, An Inquiry into What Women Saved and Assembled, Femage, synthesizes many of the key elements of feminist art in the 1970s, including an interest in reviving materials, techniques, and processes historically associated with traditional women's art, especially textiles, quilting, and collage, while emphasizing the communal and collaborative aspects of art made by women. Moses was well-versed in needlework of all types, as any female who grew up in rural America during the 1860s and 70s had to have been, especially one who worked as a hired hand, as Moses had. In addition to making embroidered pictures, which played a significant role in the development of her iconic painting style, as Jane described her, this morning, Moses also made pieced quilts and rag dolls, of which we have examples of in our collection at the Bennington Museum. Her painting, The Quilting Bee, which is on view in the gallery and in the exhibition, emphasizes the domestic, communal, female-dominated nature of this quintessential 19th century tradition. Shapiro's fabric painting, Wonderland, which is in the collection of the Smithsonian American Art Museum, is a perfect complement to Moses's painting. With its pieced border and a traditional quilt pattern and collage-like field of vintage textiles centered by a handkerchief or kerchief embroidered with a scene of a woman in a kitchen beneath the text, Welcome to Our Home, which invites the viewer, male or female, into the stereotypically feminine sphere. Given these parallels, it's surprising that Shapiro and other feminist artists, critics, and theorists didn't reference Moses directly. The lack of interest in Moses' work by first-generation feminists and postmodern insiders was likely due to two key factors. First, Moses' collage-like technique of appropriation was largely unknown until Jane Collier outed the artist in her 1982 book, Grandma Moses, The Artist Behind the Myth. Secondly, Moses' adaptations of commercial imagery were devoid of conscious irony, a key element of postmodern practice. She didn't wear an apron to be ironic. She wore an apron while she was painting because that made sense to her. That's what she would have worn to keep her clothes clean in the kitchen. Why wouldn't she wear it to keep her clothes clean while she's painting? The women's studies professor Jean McMahon Humez, a rare exception, cast Moses as a, quote, homespun feminist in an article she wrote in 1981, who supported women's suffrage, insisted on economic self-sufficiency, and was able to find a balance between her family life and her artistic career. Moses' art didn't directly take part in the intellectual underpinnings of modernism or postmodernism, yet her work is modern, is postmodern, without trying to be. After the craze for, quote, primitives in the 1930s and 40s, the works of Moses and other non-mainstream artists were positioned outside the linear historical progression of modernism proper, not significant in their own right, but as a fodder for inspiration for mainstream avant-garde artists. Postmodern theorists and practitioners such as Lepard and Shapiro began to rethink this classist, imbalanced approach in the 1970s, even if they rarely acknowledged Moses' work as a potentially significant exemplar of their ideas. In his catalog essay for the groundbreaking exhibition Parallel Visions at the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, which looked at the relationship between so-called insider and outsider art in the 20th century, the art historian Donald Preziosi posited an approach in which, quote, modernism is expanded beyond the interlinked series of avant-gardist practices canonized by art history and museology, wherein all manner of artistic practices become, in effect, part of the story of modernism, end quote. With this look at Moses' own artistic practice, in direct comparison to paragons of both modernism and postmodernism, I hope we can begin to understand her not as an anomalous, self-taught folk superhero, but as a real contributor to the story of American art of the 20th century. A disarmingly down-to-earth farm wife from rural upstate New York, Moses created visually sophisticated paintings that melded her memories of growing up in a pre-industrial America with her more recent experiences in an increasingly modernized, homogeneous America, saturated with printed images that often draw upon nostalgic tropes of a much romanticized golden age that was just beyond the direct experience of most viewers. Built on a foundation of selective memory, that of the artist as well as of the viewers of her work, and the associative power of popular imagery, her paintings have become iconic images in America's collective consciousness. Moses's paintings have been providing viewers with an eternally longed-for promised land ever since they made their way beyond the boundaries of Washington County, New York, nearly 80 years ago. Thank you.
I was just wondering if you have any details as to how her outing actually took place.
I don't know. Sally, could you tell us a little about the outing with Grandma Moses and the convertible in Bennington? I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I did mention it. You could talk with Sally. I'll be happy to introduce you. But again, she lived a 10 to 15-minute drive from Bennington, and it's this idea, I think. My point of mentioning that is because we tend to think of Moses as isolated, as in rural America in the backwoods. Eagle Bridge and Hoosick Falls had train stations. They got the Saturday Evening Post. They saw circus posters plastered on the side of buildings just like anybody else in rural America. Grandma Moses wasn't that much of an exotic outsider as we tend to have a habit of thinking of her, of as perceiving her. And I think it's just important to realize, you know, she was being driven around in, you know, convertibles by Bennington College students in the late 40s and early 50s. You know, it's not that outside of the experience of modern life as we might have a tendency to think.